Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Monday Night Magic with your favorite epigenetic geeks, myself, Lori Falk, and the amazing one and only epigeneer, Kenneth Close. Woohoo! Wow. Wow. I love that song, Heal the World, Make It a Better Place, for you and for me and the entire human race.
Those of you that were just in the green room there waiting, so Lori was playing Michael Jackson's, you know, Heal the World song for all of us to dance to.
Yes. And if you care enough for the living, make it a better place. Look, we're not going to kid you. It's a shit show out there right now. It really is. I mean, what's going on in the Middle East is nothing short of unnerving. I'm trying to tone this down. How am I doing, Ken? Unnerving instead of terrifying, unnerving. And certainly, you know, politically, there's all of that going on. And most of our audience, I'm going to guess, is pretty empathic. So even when you're controlling your own feelings and your own emotions, you're picking up on the mass consciousness. You're picking up on that energy out there. And then on top of everything else, we are in one of the most active sun cycles that the planet has been in for 23 years. So we've got there was an X43 solar flare. I remember like 15 years ago experiencing an X3, and I thought that was like huge. It's just the energy coming at us, and then the geomagnetic storms. It's like the sun does this reverse volcano and spews this energy out to us. And we're all picking up on that. We're picking up on all of those things. And all of those things are wreaking havoc with our nervous system. And that's something we're going to take a deep dive into this evening. Because here's the thing. It's easy. We could fall into a state of fear and insecurity. But what good would that do? If you're on this Zoom tonight and you're listening to this recording, if you're one of our followers, you know that everything is energy and everything is a vibrational frequency. So if you're going to put out a frequency of fear and insecurity, what are you going to attract? More fear and insecurity, right? So we are at a choice point. We can either be part of the problem or part of the solution. If you choose the latter, like I do, then one of the best things that you can do is to raise your vibrational frequency and add more love and light to the planet. Honestly, 100%, I don't watch the news. I get snippets of it from friends. I get snippets of it popping into my Facebook feed. That's enough. I promised myself eons ago, 25 eons ago, when I stopped listening to the news, that if there was ever anything I needed to know, I would find out. And I kid you not, I literally got 3 phone calls before the second tower was hit on 9/11. So that is a point proven. If I need to know, I will find out. So stay away from as much of that as you can, because we have so much power within ourselves, so much power. People say, well, which way are you going to vote? And what are you thinking about this? And what are you thinking about that? And I really don't want to sound like Pollyanna, but actually I'm just focusing on managing my nervous system and sending love and light out into the world, because that is the best gift I could give anyone. Just think of what Yoda told us in Star Wars. The Force, it's within you.
Right? You heard her say, you talked about epigenetic geeks, okay? Everything Lori's talking about is epigenetics. Epigenetics is the external influence on genetic expression. And you heard her say something about consciousness, right? There is a consciousness, just like the 4 minute mile back in the 50s, right? When that was first, that record was first made, breaking the 4 minute mile was like impossible. Because back up even further than that, back into the 1800s, it was believed. Did you know this? Think about this. It was believed if you went faster than 35 miles an hour, your body would explode. Anybody ever been faster than 35 miles an hour? Right? I mean, come on, how fast the freeway speeds? Anyway, it was believed that the body would explode. And so all of these myths were essentially rewired. And how were they rewired? Somebody did it. And that upregulated the entire belief, the entire consciousness. And so when we do something that is above and beyond normal, we give permission to the rest of consciousness to do the same. Well, guess what? When you do something that is, you know, harmful or catastrophic or evil or unserving, you do the same thing. You're amplifying signals, because out there somewhere, there's somebody that's just on the threshold of developing a new self, a new skill, a new belief. And they come across, say, maybe one of your posts or maybe a picture or something that you created that was negative, right? They're on the fence. They're on the fence. They're just thinking, who am I going to be right now? And they love you, respect you, and trust you. And it was something. Now, none of you, I'm not talking about any of you guys. I mean, no, you would not put that out there. But they come across someone that they respect, love, and honor that puts out something negative. And they go, wow, boom, there is the sway. There's the tipping point. Okay, so we are at a tipping point. We're at a tipping point pretty much every moment. When you wake up in the morning, you're at an amazing tipping point, by the way, because if you jump up or wake up and you are in the state of wonder, in the state of unknown, in the state of possibility, then when you look in the mirror, you're going to go, oh my God, look at you. Who are you? Hi, how are you? Nice to meet you, right? Brand new possibility. But how many do that? How many go to the mirror and go, oh, what is that? You know, or something, you know, it's like, oh, I got another wrinkle or you know, or something that's just doesn't feel serving. But every day, every circadian rhythm, you have a down regulation of systems, right? Moving into the sleep or rest and digest, and then an upregulation of systems to activate and to act and to become and to be, right? To thrive and create and support and all the things in your life. Every circadian rhythm. And so it's a great idea to move into the end of your circadian rhythm, which as we're moving into darkness, as the light goes away, the body's starting to turn on the rest and digest systems, the chemistry, the hormonal systems that help you to downregulate thought, organs that start to go offline to conserve energy for healing, thought processes that dim or shut down. All this is as the light diminishes, right? Your body goes into rest. Okay, so that's the time. That's the time to install one little concept. One little idea, and that's the idea of gratitude. That's the time to find anything and everything to be grateful for in that moment. As your body is going down into rest, right? It's trying to move into the parasympathetic nervous system. And as Lori was saying, we're looking at what's going on with the nervous system. Okay, we're going to talk deeply about this tonight, you guys, because I'm going to give you a little hint. There is one system that we have that is by far the most influential, the most powerful, and the most truth in our healing. One system. And that's the autonomic nervous system. And we're going to talk about that extensively. But as you build gratitude in the downregulation or the ending or the releasing of your day, I say this all the time, every night, I let go of this day. Right? I let go of this day. And I become grateful for all the things I did that day. Now, I make mistakes, right? Everybody makes mistakes. maybe I don't get something done. That's not the point. The point is I had the breath in my lungs to navigate every single thing in the day, the previous day. I had breath in my lungs. That's just one thing that you can use as a hack. If you can't think of anything you did right, I'm going to say, I do this. I level the playing field with the body. And if I can't think of anything I did right, AKA mind, I'm going to say, well, what did the body do right? Right? It had a breath in its lungs all day long to help support these systems, these organs, these cells, right? And then the next part of that circadian rhythm, you let that day go, you move on into sleep. And in the beginning of your next day, the first thing is surprise, delight, right? Why? Well, you're not guaranteed any single day. You're not guaranteed any single moment, are you? There's no guarantee. So when we wake up with delight, what do you think God is going to receive? What do you think the universe is going to receive when we wake up greeting a day with delight, a gift, right? 86,400 seconds. All right. That's the gift. Here you go. You have every second to create from. And the present moment, that second, is the only one that you can build material form with, AKA body. So it is a consciousness, the mind that is filtering out every bit of content to build a belief structure, to build a personality, to infuse content on every present moment, to build a material body. Okay. That's epigenetics at its finest. And who's in the driver's seat? We've talked about this many times, right? We're in the driver's seat. And we are, what'd I say? 86,400 seconds in a day. And you've heard me say this before. The body's recreating 800,000 cells per second. I'll bet you all of you guys were right in your mind saying it with me, right? You guys know the number. 800,000 cells per second. Times that by 86,400. Just go ahead and do that. Do the math in your head if you want. But if you got to do it on a calculator, there's going to be a whole bunch of zeros after that. That's how many cells your body is producing in one day. Your body. You're not doing it. This you that we think of as our thoughts or what we see as our senses or our consciousness, we're not doing that. The body has its own genius. It has its own system. It has its own divine mechanisms. And so it does it for you. That's a gift. I'm going to ask you guys to write this down. What am I doing with my gift today? Right? And if you ask that question of yourself in the morning, ask yourself the past tense. What did I do with my gift today? And find gratitude for all the things you did. That's going to start to hack your mind and put your autonomic nervous system in a better state of relaxation and release. So, as you heard me say, I like to level the playing field with the body. Well, what's that mean? Well, it's three-dimensional, tangible material content. Okay. Wow, Ken, you just desexified my body, right? It's like, okay, I'm not saying that. Every one of the genetic forms out there are super sexy, right? Guys, come on, you can take it. They're, all of us, it's super sexy. And the cool thing about that is that the reason it is because it's enormous amount of things it can do. And it is our vehicle. And like I mentioned before, the autonomic nervous system, the sympathetic parasympathetic system is the orchestra leader. It's the blessing of the energy fields that creates everything. It regulates. It's the referee that's in the middle of everything. And if we understand how to regulate it, right? Or how, even more so, how it works, maybe we can find the value in why we should even regulate it, or why should we even care? Right, Lori?
Absolutely. There's such a huge part of the population that actually is stressed most of the time. I was looking at, after you told me that it was 75 to 80%, I looked this up, and this is college students. Do you see on the left side that tiny little sliver that says 1.6% of the time, no stress? 1.6% of the time, the average college student is not stressed. 6.5%, less than average stress. So 8% of the time, average stress or no stress. The other 92% of the time, average stress, 34%, more than average, 45%, and tremendous stress, 12.7%. Well, I don't think we're all that different than the average college student. Because if college was tough, going and being an adult kind of upped the ante a little bit. So it's just imperative that we get this under control.
You know, and the interesting part about that is, you know, say as a college student, or well, anybody, all the way up until about the age of 35, we are building models internally of our emotional response mechanism, right? These neural networks of understanding, right? Up until about the age of 35. Now, it doesn't mean that after 35, you know, the brain shuts off. That's not it. What I'm saying is that up until that point, we're building new models all the time, variations of understanding. We're assigning meaning to experiences and to feelings within the body. In other words, emotions. We are writing the book. We are writing the operating system, right? That's going to last us the rest of our life. Now, this is just neuroscience. This is not me. This is just neuroscience said. This is about at 35 years old. This is what's going on. Some of us here are past that. Don't worry. I'm not saying that, you know, you're beyond hope. If you think like that, no. What I'm saying is we've assigned meaning. All we've done is assign meaning to a experience or an exposure to an environmental influence as to what the chemistry that's being infused into our body is known as a feeling, an emotion. We've just assigned definition. Okay, so let's do a little experiment. If there is a favorite song, right? A favorite song that you have, and you hear that favorite song, right? Does it pull up an emotion? Does it pull up a feeling? Right? Does it pull something up, some interior response? Okay, so that's an assigned meaning. That's what I'm talking about. That whenever you heard that song, whatever's going on in your life, perhaps it was, you know, a favorite song for you and your partner. It was a great experience when you were on the carousel with your buddy Lori. It was whatever it was, you know what I'm saying? And it's going to be written into your system, your memory system, your brain. And then the chemical response in your body is going to be written into the meaning of that experience as chemistry. And the combination of all that is a neural network around the feeling, right? It's a memory stimulating this feeling. And so every time the song pops up, the body just rehearses it, just does it. You don't really have to, you know, go into full on remembrance of the experience, but the song itself, the audio signal, has this autonomic response. Same thing with what you see. Everything we see, you know, let's say that you see a grizzly bear. You know, what does that say? You've probably assigned meaning. Maybe, you know, some of you don't even know what a grizzly bear is, but you've maybe seen pictures or heard documentation that goes, get the heck out of there, right? Right? Still, there's an impression in the mind. Okay, these are automatic responses. These are neural networks, understandings that you created all the way up into a certain age in your life. So if all of that information is passed assignments, then when we're trying to change something, like, you know, every time we see the color blue, we get shivers, right? Because blue represents cold or something like that, right? And it's something that just doesn't serve you right, right? Especially if you're, you know, in the middle of a conference in front of a whole bunch of people and the blue something pops up and you're, you know, this is an automatic response. You know, maybe it doesn't serve you right. So if there's something like that, this assignment, right, that doesn't serve you well, that was built before you were 35 years old. And by the way, the neuroscience says that over 50% of those assignments, those meanings of the experience that you attach to an emotion to, are not even real. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Not even real. Yeah. Yeah. So the reason I'm saying that is because if you and a buddy were in an experience back when you were teenagers, right, and you assign the meaning and all that, and then, you know, at your 40th high school year reunion, you get together and talk about that experience, and he's telling all about this snake that was like the size of a, you know, a python, and it wrapped around him and drug him down to the river. And you're like, wait, no, it was a little garden snake and it didn't even come in our tent. I mean, come on, right? So information is embellished based on personality that develops over life. So again, half that story is not even true, but you've assigned meaning to it. And the moment you rehearse it, the body just goes right into the action of the feeling. And so just like the color blue stimulating a shiver when you see it, optic nerve says information to the brain. Brain interprets content. Content becomes a thought. Thought becomes a chemical messenger called a peptide. Peptide goes to the body. Body experiences a feeling. Boom. Full on experience. You see how that works? Now, okay, with all that information right there, if we're trying to change some aspect of ourselves, I think the fundamental question, and write this down, needs to be, what from my past no longer belongs in my future? Right? What from my past no longer belongs in my future? And if it's a feeling of shiver, we need to decide what we want to do with those triggers. This is the autonomic nervous system. This is these neural networks in the brain that trigger information to go to the body to produce the chemistry to give you the feeling, or the muscular vibrational contractions to feel the shiver. We can break those cycles. We just need to understand the way, we understand what systems are doing this. We need to understand and assign new meaning to content. This takes rehearsal, folks. This takes practice. I'm not saying that, you know, that we're an expert right away. And if we work at it and work at it and work at it, and we're still not getting quite a response, you're just not good enough yet. Now, that's not an insult. It's just, if you're dribbling the basketball, and you've done it for 6 months and you still don't feel like you're any better, well, if you're training yourself, sometimes self is not an objective observer. It's a subjective observer, right? So who's going to help you with critical information or adjustments, right? You need a coach. Maybe you need some outside influence. Maybe you need a mentor to help you dribble the basketball, okay? Same thing here. But if you don't identify that the color blue is the causation for your shiver, and then you decide that shiver does not belong in your future, if you don't do that work, just like admitting that there's an issue, then you really aren't going to make very many lasting changes, okay? So the body does not know the difference between an experience you make up in your mind, aka hearing a song, and a body experience, or a three-dimensional real-time event that's happening to you right now. The body does not know the difference. It is your servant. It is your gift. And the autonomic nervous system is what the ANS, I'll call it ANS for short, it is what regulates all that interface between sensory content and body expression. That's how your body becomes a body, cell by cell. It's through the interface of the autonomic nervous system. So if we want to make sure that we are properly managing that nervous system, we need to maybe be able to measure it, right? Maybe be able to see, because sadly, like Lori said in that pie chart there, the majority of people are in some form of stress response. And I have a device, a watch that measures my HRV. HRV is a great indicator, a great gauge for taking a look at where you're at. And HRV stands for heart rate variability. You can look that up. It has a lot of influence over your vagal tone or that vagus nervous system. That's again part of the autonomic system. So when we can watch HRV with a device of some sort, we can see what's happening to us in real time. And most people, when you start measuring things, I'm going to give you a little hint, and this might not sound great, but we have normalized stress so much. We have epigenetically adapted to stress response that we've normalized a state of chaos. And again, I level the playing field with the body. No matter how much stress you say you can take, how many people out there say, I got a high pain tolerance, right? Ever hear that? I got a high pain tolerance. I'm sorry. It's no better than saying, oh, I can drink a lot of alcohol and not be drunk. Now I got a high alcohol content tolerance. It's no better. It's not better. High pain tolerance means that you've normalized suffering. Wow. Ouch. Right. And ladies that have had children, I, you know what? I love you. And you have reason to say I have a high pain tolerance, right? You have reason that you know, pain is a thing, and you've lived through it. It's like, wow. But to say that I have a high pain tolerance and to normalize that is not listening to your body. It's not actually pairing and partnering. No different than saying that I can drink my buddy under the table. You know, you've just normalized something that's toxic. I know, Ken, I don't want to hear that crap, but I'm just saying that's the truth. I level the playing field with the body. And if we don't figure out how to start speaking truth, then body will not change. So we need to really, like Lori said, if we're watching the news, what happens to our drama normal parameter, our bandwidth for drama, our bandwidth for chaos and disorder, and maybe untruth, our bandwidth for content that's not serving us? It gets bigger and bigger and bigger. No different than listening to certain music that has words in it that are hateful, damaging, and chaotic. You know, and we know many, many studies that when you talk improperly or harshly to a plant, it's going to suffer, or a pet, right? Or anything containing water. Water is the same. It holds information. So when we speak those words or listen to that music or engage in those conversations or take on the news or the content, even if it's a movie, folks, we normalize disorder. We normalize chaos. We normalize a sympathetic, which is the fight or flight. We normalize a sympathetic nervous system response, and we allow it to feel normal. We allow that chaos inside of our body, where our body is disassembling and destroying itself inside. And we say, oh, I can sit here in calm and peace. Emergency responders, firefighters, police officers, you know, even lifeguards, and people in the medical industry that are under those extreme conditions, you know, even night shift workers, all of that demographic normalizes a higher state of stress. And just because you can do it doesn't mean that it's building a body of health, well-being, and vitality. Right? Anything you want to expand on that, Lori?
Yeah. You know, I think the hardest part, Ken, is for people to admit that they've got an issue going on, to actually, you know, say, yes, I'm not 100%. And like, I dealt with mental illness, so I get this on a big, big, big level. But let's not use my story tonight. Let's look at what's going on current event-wise. Let's just take a peek at the Olympics. Talk about people who have to listen to their bodies, right? You're looking at athletes that are performing at world-class levels, and they have to be aware of what's going on physically, emotionally, mentally, and spiritually within themselves, or they can't keep up at the pace that they're keeping up. And one story in particular that was brought to my attention in the last week or so was Simone Biles. Well, why do you think I paid attention? She's married to a former Green Bay Packer. Seriously. Somebody started telling me about her, and then they said, well, she was married to a Green Bay Packer. And all of a sudden, I'm listening. Anyway, the fact of the matter is that in the 2020 Tokyo Olympics, she had to admit that her nervous system was breaking down. She started, I mean, she was doing, as a gymnast, things that were, these moves were very dangerous if you weren't 100% in alignment with what's going on with you mentally, physically, emotionally, all simultaneously. And she did a couple of vaults where she just almost fell. And she admitted it, to the point where she dropped out of the Olympics because she didn't want to hold her team back. And hey, how about, she might have gotten hurt really, 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 really bad. So she said that she was going to drop out and focus on her mental health. Do you know what a big deal that is? To say, I have to drop out of the Olympics to focus on my mental health. Well, I think if she could do that, we can admit when there's something going on for us. And yes, she did come. She caused others to come forth. Yes, absolutely. I can't agree more. And that's why I've always been so public about the fact that I've dealt with mental illness. Because if we, those of us who have dealt with it, don't come forward and tell our stories, then other people are going to hide in the shadows too. But if we come forward and we admit, this is what's going on for me, and say, and here's how I fixed it. So she drops out, admits the whole thing, works on her mental health, comes back, and wins the gold this year. She won the gold for, wait for it, not just the all-around Olympic champion in gymnastics, but the oldest. She's 27 years old. Normal lifespan of a gymnast used to be about 19. And at 27, she's the third woman in history to win multiple golds in the all-around and the first to win all-around titles 8 years apart, right? Because she had dropped out in 2020. And I got to show you this. It's just a short clip. I promise it's not long. But I was so impressed by this that I just thought I'd share it with you. This is what can happen when you take care of yourself.
Triple double, hardest tumbling path in the entire world right there. one-tenth out of bounds.
So this is what I'm talking about. If she hadn't admitted it, if she hadn't dropped out, if she hadn't taken care of herself, she might have got hurt, and she have just consciousness bumps all over. I don't think she could have come back and done that at 27.
You see the consciousness development, just like the 4 minute mile. You see the development process and what we look at this and we go, wow, that's amazing. And that wow, that thing that happened inside of you watching that. And if you assign gratitude, if you assign appreciation, if you assign that wonder, that awe, you're amplifying her signal and anyone else after that, including yourself. Epigenetically. Does that make sense? So if I think that when we're looking at these things from our past, remember the question, did you guys write it down? What from my past belongs in my future, right? The next stage or the next phase of that question after that. Okay. If it doesn't belong in my future, am I willing to surrender it? If it doesn't belong in my future, am I willing to surrender it? I'm not saying work on it. I'm not saying visit it every now and then. I'm not saying rehearse it ever again. I'm saying, am I willing to surrender it? Am I willing to surrender some aspect of my personality? Because that entire assignment process, when we have assigned meaning up until the age of 35 of all of this stuff in our lives, creates our personality, right? That's who we are. We say that all the time. I've heard it so many times. Well, that's just who I am. No, that's who you've rehearsed. That's who you believe to be. And that's who you've surrendered to. That's it. So if we are willing to surrender something, guess what? A new personality emerges. I guarantee you. I mean, I've evolved myself so much in my life. My personality today, if we all met 10 years ago or 12 years ago, 2012 was a huge pivotal moment for many people in the world, but especially in my life. If we met then, I'm not so sure that we'd be friends. I'm just saying. But the thing is that the people we meet today are meeting the person that we have developed because we were willing to surrender something we didn't like. They didn't know us before. They have no idea who you were before. Meeting new people today is meeting the new you today. Who do you want to be? Who do you want to be? What do you want to surrender? What no longer belongs in your future? What are you willing to surrender to achieve a new personality? And I understand, folks, we've worked hard to be this. Maybe we've got some college under our belt. We have a whole ton of experience under our belt. We've practiced a lot under our belt. We've done so many things. We have a physical characteristic that we just honor and love. And yet our health, our vitality, our wellness is suffering somewhere. So if that's the truth, all I'm saying is I will level the playing field with the body. Anyone who works with me will get a whole lot of grace, a whole lot of patience, but zero sympathy. Sympathy is just not serving. Empathy is different. Empathy is different. Sympathy says, I will get on board your pity party and I will live there with you. Now there's two of us suffering. Okay. Empathy says, I will listen to your pity party. I will offer you a tool and a time limit, and I'm going to drag your butt out of here if you're willing to come with me. That's empathy. Which one would you rather have? Which person would you rather have in your corner? Because one keeps you in a state of chaos, disorder, and suffering, and a body diminishing in health. The other gives you a path. Gives you a path to become who you want to be. To build a life and a success story of your dream. Two different scenarios, right? Okay. So let's just break down a little bit about what that means. The autonomic nervous system It is comprised of two sections, right? The parasympathetic, which is rest and digest. You've heard this before. And the sympathetic, which is fight or flight. They're both very necessary. The sympathetic nervous system is usually what we're in when we are in our brain is in what's called beta wave, beta frequency waveform. That's in the analytical sense. You're learning, like the college students Lori was talking about. You're learning, you're trying to understand, you're focused, you're in, you know, the moment. And there is disorder, there's chaos, there's restructuring going on of your brain and your body. This is the same state you're in when you're in physical working out, right? When you're exercising, you're preparing, you're creating, you're still in that beta brainwave and you're in the sympathetic nervous system. Okay. So all of that system stimulates a heightened sense of awareness, acuity, ability, right? It regulates your digestive system differently, right? It regulates energy consumption in proper areas for you to perform. When I mean perform, the body to do things. So training for the Olympics, for instance, they're in that stress response a lot, right? But they're also training their mind to try to down-regulate its height or its amplitude. They're working their mind to do that. Okay. So now on the other side, the parasympathetic state, that's the rest and digest state. That's when the brain is in alpha brainwave state, more in the trance state, the sleepy state, all the way into delta and theta, right? Into sleep. This is why, you know, the majority of your repair, recovery, and growth happens in your circadian rhythm between midnight and 2 a.m. It doesn't matter where you are. It's the same section, no matter where you are in the world, between midnight and 2 a.m. And you need to be in that deep sleep to be really optimizing that repair, recovery, and growth. And that's when the mind is completely offline. The mind is offline and it's not regulating any of the chemistry in your body. This is the significance. It's not regulating any of the chemistry in your body. Because when we have cortisol responses, which is the sympathetic, it disallows certain human growth hormones that your body would want to have on board for cell regeneration. Okay, so it just can't repair itself properly in the sympathetic nervous system. And vital energy to very important systems is controlled by that autonomic nervous system. So in sympathetic, all energy is taken from the body. The brain regulates all this. All energy is taken from other systems in the body to work muscles, to work the frontal lobe for analysis, right? The creative brain in the back, the archive part, is offline, kind of waiting for information to be understood so that then it can be placed into memory. This is where you study over and over and over again. You finally get into the memory. It winds up into the archives, right? And you don't forget it unless you're studying quantum physics. And then sometimes you forget stuff. Anyway, it's just rehearsal. So when we are in that sympathetic system, three essential systems lose energy. Number one, your digestive system. It loses energy. It, in other words, doesn't have the energy for muscle contraction to move content. It doesn't have the energy for restructuring matter into chemistry. It doesn't have the energy for managing toxic burden, which is also ingested. It does not have the energy. And so it goes offline to some degree. Okay, system number two, immune system. The immune system is not needed when we're in fight or flight. It's not trying to keep you from catching a cold. It's simply, you know, the body is, again, trying to protect itself. So immune system, why do you think people that are in a high stress response have a cold all the time or something going on in their body all the time, seems like, right? And number three, Number three is reproduction, right? Reproduction. It's not time to create life when you're in some panic modality, right? I mean, think about it. Okay, you're with your partner, you know, you're working on creating a family and you're in the moment and you're worried about what's for dinner. or it's like, oh crap, did I get that email done today? I mean, you're in the height of passion and your mind goes into this other thing and the body is the instrument, the servant to our mind, and the body goes into stress response. You ruin the moment. Talk about a buzzkill. I'm just saying, you know? So we're all adults here. This is just real. This is just how the body works. And I hear so many young people that are working on trying to create a family, and they're doing, you know, all kinds of chemical therapies, and they're still not having a family. They're still not getting back because he's working two jobs. You know, she's working a job trying to figure out how to make ends meet, right? They have family political issues. They're engaged in politics, engaged in the suffering, and engaged in the news. And it's falling apart. The body's having an autonomic nervous system response of parasympathetic. Okay. And like I said, too often we're normalizing that. We're going, that's just how it is. That's just how it is. Okay. With all that, what do we do? Lori, let's talk about how we can do some stuff.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you were talking earlier, Ken, about songs triggering things. And honestly, music and I are like just so tight. And if I want to process my emotions, music is the easiest way for me to do that. And when I went through my divorce, hearing any of the songs from the beginning of that relationship used to just lay me out. And years, decades later, it still was going on. If I heard those songs, I'd get like all choked up and all emotional. And then I got this advice. And then I started using the coaching module. Those same songs, nothing. I mean, nothing. In fact, I actually was at Whole Foods one day and I parked my car and I looked to my left and the guy sitting in the car next to me looked exactly like my ex-husband, who I haven't seen in over 20 years. And you know what I said? I went, huh, that's interesting. I wasn't moved at all by that. And then, in addition to this, many of you know, I'm also a visionary artist and I've created this artwork that is loaded with energy frequencies and healing abilities. And oh my goodness. I was telling Ken yesterday, I needed to balance my nervous system. So I've got this amazing saltwater pool in my condo. And I went down there and I just swam my butt off. I just swam and got out of that pool. And I was going to go for a walk. I was all rubbed up. And then I got tired. And I'm like, oh, this isn't going to work. I still, it's early. It's only 6 o'clock. I got a lot of stuff to do yet here tonight. So I went and I stood in front of the activation angel, which literally amplifies anything it's close to. And I could feel waves of energy coming at me. And I was still texting Ken at 1 a.m. So I know it worked. And we have a wonderful inner peace angel. And it's just peaceful just looking at her. Totally peaceful. And the message, each of these are angelic message portraits, and each of them has a message from the angels about a particular issue. This one's about peace. So the inner peace angel helps us to reach deep within ourselves and get in touch with that calm, peaceful center that lies at the core of our very being. She reminds us of the importance of staying centered in the eye of the hurricane. For when we can remain this centered, the world around us has an opportunity to do the same. For we, as a microcosm of the universe, are ever impacting the interconnectedness of all that is. So she literally speaks to what we've been talking about all night here, right? The forces within you.
See, and I love that because just as we've been talking, what's important is that we build things. We're going to be exposed to things that cause triggers that aren't serving us. So it's even more important to create things or attach to things that trigger us in ways we do like. Okay. So Lori mentioned music. She mentioned art. So these things, look around your world, everyone. This is your homework. If we want some action items, we've got to have some homework. I mentioned earlier, wake up in wonder, right? Wake up in wonder. Who am I? I don't even know until I look in the mirror. Oh, there you are. Hey, amazing. Okay. Let go of this day in gratitude. Let go of the day in gratitude, not regret. You know how many people are in regret at the end of the day? I'm not going to talk about percentages, but just we're in a certain form. Okay. At the end of the day, make it gratitude. Find something, anything to be grateful for. I know you guys are all still breathing. You're here. So you must have some amazing technical savvy how to get on a Zoom call, right? Hey, give yourself credit. Millions of people do not know how to do exactly what you just did tonight. Millions, and even more so, can't even read. Think about that. Okay, so be grateful. I know you can find something. The next part of your homework, and this is something that is done during your waking day, and that is to find things you can assign meanings of joy to. It can be a song, meanings of love to. It can be a painting, meanings of fulfillment, wholeness. Okay. Those things, find things in your life that already exist. I promise you they're there. I promise you they're there. But when the sympathetic nervous system is engaged, you will never see them. You won't see them. So we can hack that by seeking them out first. This is your expedition requirement. Seeking them out first. And when you find them, you will sway your nervous system, your autonomic nervous system, into parasympathetic. It'll happen that quick. Find a piece of art. Find some music. Find a scenery. Find something to trigger your senses. How many senses do you have, right? 6. One is intuition. Okay. So you have what you hear, what you see, what you smell, what you taste, what you feel. When I say feel, that's the body's emotional feel, what you touch, but also intuitively, you can pull up a feeling just through intuition if we tune in. But using the main senses of the body, which is what we see, taste, touch, and feel, do this exercise. Find two things that you see that stimulate a feeling of joy or love. Just two things that you see, right? All right. Find one thing that you can taste. Something you taste that stimulates satisfaction. Just be satisfied in that moment, right? Find one thing that you can listen to, you can hear, right? That fulfills wholeness. That just how you feel like, I'm complete in this moment. Right? I'm just complete. And then something that you can touch, right? Something you can touch that starts to stimulate a calm, a feeling of exhale, right? Like, have you ever pet your pet, pet your buddy, pet your four-legged furry friend? Yeah, that feeling, right? Yeah. So do this exercise. And this is a physical exercise. This is homework that we need to do every day. If you did this and you made this your habit, you know, it doesn't take long. But as you start doing that, what you're doing is you're assigning new meaning to a trigger, right? The next phase of that, as you develop that skill, is assigning a new trigger to old content that doesn't serve you. So you can either release it or you start reassigning. Reassigning is the next phase. Okay. So there's your homework. You know, it is important that I know we're justified in being fed up or angry or frustrated, or we could get on board with a friend's struggle, sadness, chaos. We can do that. But the problem is the more we do that, we normalize our state of being, and you're no good to anyone in suffering. So I'm inviting you to tend to your own garden first, right? To tend to your autonomic nervous system and start building a ANS fitness system, right? To where you're improving the fitness, the well-being of your autonomic nervous system. Because just that one thing, I promise you, if you are able to do that and you follow that protocol 30 days, it's the most effective weight loss program. It's the most effective memory recall system. It's the most effective coherence program, de-wrinkling,
anti-aging,
improved digestion, sleep regulatory process. There is known to man and woman. And, you know, and that has been my work, my mission, exclusively and hard for the last 4 years. And we just built a system that now is coming out in the world, to be able to take a look at that most important part of you and then building balancing mechanisms around it. So we have this tool that is part of that system, right? But just stop normalizing chaos and disorder. Stop being okay with being stressed out. I'm asking you, stop allowing your struggle to be your daily habit. All right? Who's in? Let's do it. Let's do it.
I'm in. And there's been some questions in the chat about what programs. I mean, what I was referring to earlier was the coaching module, but then I'm like the Healy coaching queen. So I know how powerful that model is. And I actually have now created a way to take my angels and put them into the coaching module. And I just did that with Ken this past week. And powerful, wasn't it?
Oh my gosh. So let me tell you, folks, I like the performance. I like, let's hit me hard. Watch out what you ask for, because your autonomic nervous system is going to be the one receiving that information. And Lori ran some stuff very long periods of time. And it did, you know, it did some fandangling, and you know, we just have to be able to recognize it and then do a bunch more self-care. So super, super duper effective. And I'm just so blessed by being able to do that with you. And so everybody, I recommend it.
Thank you. And let us not forget that there are a plethora of programs in here that will help balance the nervous system. Bed rest is certainly one in the sleep programs. But the one that is the most overlooked, because if you weren't here when it came out, it doesn't get talked about. And that's rebalance. And that's in the bioenergetic support category. And Marcus brought that out at the end of pandemic. Let's call it the end of the pandemic. Obviously, COVID is still going on, but the end of the pandemic, the end of the lockdowns, because we had gone through 2 years of fear, loneliness, frustration. I mean, it just, it impacted us. I guess we have four immune systems, because he said it helps with the physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual immune systems to rebalance them. And I find it to be an amazing program. Whenever I'm feeling a little out of sorts, I run that. And now we have cosmic growth. That's new. Most people know about that. But bioenergetic boost was actually designed, or bioenergetic boost. The boost was designed during, at the beginning of COVID, to support your immune system.
Yeah, the bioenergetic boost came out, and it's assigned, you know, it's the one that was given to everybody. It first was launched in Asia, and again, created, and unofficially, we won't say it was created for some, you know, condition that showed up. but it was designed to boost the immune system to a different level, to a different frequency. Our immune system, think of it this way, our immune system is tuned to what it's exposed to. Okay. So people that stay in the house all the time, that limit their movement around the planet, when you get outside that environment, then your body is going to get exposed to different things, and it's not going to have defenses, I guess you might call it. It's basically genetic coding. It won't have defenses against it. And so your body's going to have a response, and it could be many things depending on your current condition. Could be the straw that breaks the camel's back for you to get a disease of some sort, right? All right. So anyway, so bioenergetic boost was designed for that particular pandemic stimulus. I'm being very diplomatic here, trying to be and compliant. But it was made to help increase your immune system without being exposed to the condition. Does that make sense? So that's what it was for. So where Lori's talking about these other programs, one of the ones that I think I want to also mention is everybody, not everybody has the same edition of Healy, but everybody has the gold. And on the gold page, there is balance, right? So balance, that program is, it's not just for like mental stress, but it is autonomic nervous system balance. When I say that we don't even realize how far off the scale of balance we are, I'm not kidding. And so when we start running these things to help balance us, and on the gold cycle page is balance. And that's a great one to help us to work that sympathetic, parasympathetic back into balance. Okay. All right. And then, yes, so Elman says there's rebalance as part of the power of three. And it's good to have, to know where all these things are. It's not everybody has, you know, all the program availability, but if we can talk about some of the, at least the basics, then I know everybody's going to have that, and that's great. Okay, who's going to work on their autonomic nervous system? Who's going to ANS Fitness? Woo, let's go to ANS Fitness, and let's start working on that autonomic nervous system, and just watch your body turn back the clock. I mean, you know, you're going to hear more and more about it, and we're going to have an episode about this coming up down the road around the Quora effect and what that means, so that, you know, you guys can start understanding that there is ways to test, you know, and be able to look it deeper into us, and really give a objective score, so that we can see how what we're doing is influencing who we're being. Right? Wouldn't you like to know that?
Oh, I cannot wait. You know that. I cannot wait. I'm so excited about this.
Awesome.
Be able to have tests that show your nervous system, which is like the powerhouse of your entire system. So yep. Amazing.
Yeah. And I mean, just in closing, I know we got to go. We're a little bit over our time here. There is a 5-minute test that takes your sinus rhythm, your HRV, and takes a look at a different frequency. It's the alpha frequency from your HRV reading, where if you've ever looked, if you've ever been connected to a heart rate monitor, and you can see the sinus rhythm, and they're giving you a heart rate, and the peak of those spikes are at a certain period of time. Okay, that's your HRV, your heart rate variability. That's what they're measuring. And so the closer those peaks are to exact timing, in other words, exactly 60 beats per minute and not 59.9 or 60.2, the closer they are to exactly 60, that's telling the coherence between the brain triggering and the heart response and the biofeedback between the two, which is done through what? Your autonomic nervous system. Okay. So we're able to measure an alpha wave off of that pattern and break it down in order to look at more than just HRV or sinus rhythm. We're able to take a look and know now the response time between the nervous system and hormonal chemistry, right? We're able to look at how your body's utilizing vital force or energy. We're able to look at what we call a stress index response. Essentially 11 panels, we're able to look at things. And I'm telling you, and the key is we look at that, and then it's just like stepping on the scale to find out how much you weigh, right? And you use the same scale over and over, and then you go out in your world and you do something. And then you come back and get on the scale and see, did it change? You go up or down? You know, is what I'm doing serving me or not serving me? But we're not measuring this. We're not measuring the autonomic nervous system. We're looking at heart rates. We're looking at sinus rhythm, and we're saying, oh, your HRV is way out of whack. Well, thanks. You know, thanks. Now what? Okay. Well, you know, to be able to know how it's influencing you, if you knew your body's hormonal or chemical response to neurological triggering and the return effect, right? Instead of punishing the glands in our body that create those secretions and either cutting them out or chemicalizing them, what if we just worked on how that communications channel could improve? I mean, I level the playing field with the body. I'm like, let's stop punishing the body for doing its job and giving it blood pressure medication when it really just needs to regulate stress. I don't know. Makes sense to me, you guys. You guys.
He's underplaying all of this as per normal. It's amazing. It's incredible. And we can't wait to share it with you. So stay tuned. It will be happening in the next few months. And we look forward to seeing all of you again on September 9th. Invite your friends, tell everybody about it, because it's going to be getting better and better and better.
Maybe we talk about, you know, how we're going to be doing this measurement and what kind of ways we're going to be shifting it. I don't know.
Maybe. And rumor has it, the Source documentary is going to be live streamed again at some point. They haven't given out a date yet, but rumor has it. In the meantime, you can rent it for $15. You can purchase it for $30 on their website. So,
And this is inner research, innerscienceresearch.com, innerscienceresearch.com. Inner science is one word. Innerscienceresearch.com gives you the ability to go and take a look at that Source documentary. Please do. And the reason I say that is because you're going to start to learn a little bit more about the power that your body has to heal itself and build its own chemistry. This is why what we're talking about is so critical, because you have that power. And I want to give the body their power back. How about you?
Because the force, it's within you.
All right, you guys. Thanks for being here.
Thank you. Thank you, Ken. I always love working with you. You're amazing. Thank you, everyone. We love you so much. And we look forward very, 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 very much to seeing you in September. And I'll get the recording out to you ASAP as well.
Hey, quick thing before we leave. If any of you guys are advanced Dr. Joe students, okay, so Dr. Joe Dispenza, you know, I do a lot of that work, but if you've ever been to a week-long or you're part of an advanced community of that training, he is having a live half-day presentation training this Wednesday. So any of you guys are advanced students, you're on Lori's mailing list, maybe reach out to her. I can guide you as to how to get involved in that and be on a half day training. But again, it's required that you've had at least a week long or at least an advanced training, just because that's what's going to be done. Moving the needle, folks, amplifying the signal, healing the planet. And even if you haven't been to those type of events, the student body who is, we're doing it for you. We're doing it for you, with you, and just raising the energy. That's what we're doing. So love the world.
What's your data on that? What's the data?
It is Wednesday. Wait a minute. Sorry. It is Thursday the 15th is when that half day training, it's a live stream. In order to get access to the live stream, you have to be on that advanced portal. So, but anyway, I just wanted to announce that if anybody's out there, if you know somebody that's out there that does it, opportunity.
Absolutely. Thank you for sharing that.
All right, guys.
All right. Have a wonderful evening, everyone. We love you and we'll see you soon.
Shalom. Shalom.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.